Fos family.
Hi, friends.
Hello there.
I'm really glad that you chose to spend your time with us today.
We are so glad you have decided to
join us today.
I think it's going to be a great experience for you.
It's going to be an amazing day.
We're glad to be with you.
Welcome to Fos.
Hi, I'm Mike Arvin, the worship leader at Fos Community Church. We are so glad you have chosen to worship with us online today, and we would love to connect with you. After the service is over, please visit foschurch.com and complete a connect form. You will find that under the header, Start Here. You can also fill out that form on the Fos Community Church app, which is available on the App Store. Do want to let you know this comes with a no-hassle guarantee. At this point, we just want to make sure you are receiving our emails so you can learn more about Fos Church and more about how you can connect with us.
Hey guys, how are you? Hope you're doing great. Listen, I want to talk to you for just a moment about daily hope. Daily hope is exactly what it says, daily hope. It's just a shot of inspiration, of hope, to get you through these days. The challenge with today is it's so daily. I asked folks on Daily Hope today what they believe is the best part about Daily Hope. So listen to them. This is Melissa Velasco. This is what she says. This Daily Hope is so great for me because I can hear a familiar voice during this time. I love to read the comments and hear how others are feeling and what they're doing. We can praise over those who are doing well and pray for those who are struggling. That's exactly what we do. We have community on Daily Hope. It's a chance for you to sound off, to be prayed for, to tell us how you're doing, whether you're doing great or not so great, to lift each other up. It's the community that you need during this season. So this, friends, is your chance to join us, to build some community, to find some hope and inspiration, and to build each other up and be built up when you need to be built up. So I hope to see you on Daily Hope on our Facebook page, 12:15 during the weekdays. We'll see you. Bye-bye.
Hey there, Foes family. It is so exciting to be on here with you this morning. I wanted to remind you about our online small group that is happening via Facebook and Zoom every Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. You are welcome to join us. It's open to everyone. I don't want anybody sitting at home not connecting. This is an opportunity for you to connect and grow even amidst the crazy. So please join us. Just go onto our Facebook page. There is an event there that it will have all the details, the meeting ID, and everything that you need to connect via Zoom. Join us at 8 and we'll be there. I'll let you in. And it's just an awesome way to just be real with a bunch of people in the midst of all of this. We look forward to seeing you on Wednesday nights.
Hi friends, I'm Laura. I'm the children's minister at FOS, and I just wanted to let you know what we have going on for families. If you've got a kiddo fifth grade and under, and you are part of our Kids and Their Families email list, then you are getting an email every week with all the resources for you to do church at home. It has the video in there, the activities for the family, and everything. If you would like to be on that and you are not getting our emails, you can email me at laura@foschurch.com. The other thing we're doing is just sending out a fun video for kids each week onto our YouTube playlist called FOS Kids. You can find that under my name, Laura Cochran, on YouTube. Those videos have music, they have games to play, devotions, anything that'll kind of help keep your kids occupied for a little bit and help them connect to what's going on back at church. We love you all and we miss you all. Hope you'll tune in.
Hello there, Brandon here. Just wanted to let you know what's going on for our students right now in case you'd missed. Currently, we have small groups happening most days of the week, but typically on Wednesdays and Sundays. There's groups for middle school guys and girls, high school guys and girls, various age groups and stuff. And so if you're interested in your student being involved in that, all you got to do is email me at brandon@foschurch.com, or you can call or text at 502-265-8665. Also, each week, usually on Sundays or Mondays, I upload a video to YouTube, a teaching video for our students to get some good biblical teaching throughout the week if they want it, or for anybody for that matter. You can actually look that up on YouTube on my YouTube channel, which is Jedi Pastor Pharaohs. Jedi Pastor is one word, J-E-D-I-P-A-S-T-O-R. And then Brose, B-R-O-S-E. I also upload that to Facebook as well for people that can check it out on there. But that's what we've got going on. If you have any questions, if there's anything I can do for you guys, please don't hesitate to give me a call or a text.
If FOS is your home church, or God has laid it on your heart to give to support the ministries of FOS, I want to let you know of a few different ways that you can do that. Again, on our website, foschurch.com, there's an area where you can give. And also on the FOS Community Church app, on the bottom right of your screen is an area where you can give. Either way, both of these are secure. You can also mail in a check. We have a post office box, P.O. Box 333, Buckner, Kentucky, 40010. However you give, we always encourage you to seek God in your giving and be obedient to whatever it is He's calling you to do.
Hi again. I know you already heard from me, but I have a couple updates. Number one is about today. Today during the service, if you are a kiddo and you are going to be listening to the message and you would like something to do while you listen, we are providing a couple different coloring pages for you that go along with the message today. So you can check your email if you receive emails from me for FOS Kids, or you can visit the sermon notes portion of the app to print those out and color at home. The second announcement is about Alive Camp. Alive Camp is a camp that we have had for several years at our church building with hundreds of people running around all close together having a lot of fun. So, to safely and responsibly hold a live camp this year, we are transitioning to a live at home. This will be a really great experience. I know it won't be the exact same, but there might be some benefits that you'll enjoy about this camp more than you enjoy about the camp that we actually hold at the building. So for this camp, we still would like for you to sign up at foschurch.com or on the Fos Church app to come to camp. If you're 4 years old through eighth grade, sign up at those two locations by clicking events and then kids events and click a live camp. You'll sign up, put your information in, and then we'll be all set. On June 1st, you will receive an email that has the information about how to watch a live camp at home. It's going to be a different experience. We'll still have music and a story on that. And then instead of doing different tracks through the week where you can choose a different thing to learn, we will have lots of different videos that you can enjoy separately on a YouTube playlist to help you learn lots of new things this summer. So the best thing about Alive this year might be that you, instead of just having to choose one thing to learn, you might get to learn a whole bunch of different things. So I hope you like it. We also will have a packet of goodies for you to pick up the week before camp, and that will be at our church building location. So if you are watching this from out of town, you're welcome to participate. If you are watching this local, you can participate and also get the goodies, but you don't have to have the goodies in order to participate in camp. But nonetheless, still sign up because we'd like to send you something in the mail if that's okay too. If you are someone who would love to volunteer for Alive, if you're part of our Fos family, we would appreciate that greatly. We have three needs for Alive. One is to be a part of a singing, dancing thing. If that interests you, you would record it from your home. Two is being a part of writing a note to a camper. That's just going to be an adopt-a-camper part of our volunteers this year. We are hoping to get every single camper prayed over and adopted with a card in the mail to them the week of camp. And that's just a goal that we have, to connect each camper with someone that's praying for them specifically and writing them a note. So even if you've never volunteered for Alive before, that's a really great way to just kind of jump in and start. The third way to volunteer for Alive is if you have some sort of skill set or gift that you can teach kiddos over video. We would like to know that too. Hope that makes sense. Go to foschurch.com to sign up for camp, and go to foschurch.com and click events and click kids if you want to sign up to volunteer. We really need volunteers, especially that might want to sing and dance. Even if you're not good at singing and dancing, that might be better. So click and volunteer. We would love to have your support, have your participation. We could maybe, because we're online this year, have maybe more campers than ever before. So I hope you'll sign up and hope you'll be a part. You can also check the Fos Kids page on the website with all the events. They've been updated to reflect our season that we're in so that we can still hold as many of those events for you as we can. Hope you'll enjoy worship today, and it's been good seeing you. Thanks for listening. Chaos back in.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy. Thank you.
never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
Here's the question of the day, guys. How do you fight an invisible enemy? What do you do when you have an enemy that wants to wipe you out? This COVID-19 virus is hidden. It's stealthy. It's a predator. And it tries to come after us. One encounter I had with the predator and prey situation was when I was a biology teacher at Oldham County High School. And in those days, you could have all kinds of animals in your classroom. And I had dozens and dozens of animals. I had lots of fish tanks with all kinds of different fish. I had probably 100 gerbils with gerbil tubes all running and through the ceiling and spinning wheels and all kinds of things like that. We had a big buck rabbit stank like crazy. I had a chinchilla for a while, a beautiful little animal called Dusty. And then I had a ferret. The ferret had the most personality of all and stank worse than anything in the room. He hadn't been descented, and ferrets are very curious, and they're just slinky, wonderful animals. His name was Marmaduke. And Marmaduke the ferret brought a lot of joy to my students in the biology classroom, mostly in ninth grade introductory biology classroom. So occasionally students like Nick Daly, who comes to church here at FOS, would take these animals home for the weekend. On one particular long weekend though, Nick couldn't take him and nobody else could take any of the animals home, and so we had a long weekend, and then we wound up having snow days after that weekend. So I left Marmaduke the ferret in his cage, sealed up in the front corner of my room. He was right by the door as you come in the door. And so I left him there on that Friday after school was over, made sure everybody had food and water, and I locked my door and I left for what turned out to be a very long weekend with the snow days added. I didn't tell you though that there was a snake in the classroom as well. He was a 6-foot boa constrictor. I don't remember his name, I just called him Snake. And I always used the snake, by the way, when we had parent-teacher conferences, because I discovered if I was holding the snake and carried him, no parents would want to talk to me, and my parent-teacher conferences were very brief, if I had them at all, so I enjoyed parent-teacher conferences a lot with just the snake. Well, on this particular weekend, the long weekend with the snow days added, Marmaduke the ferret managed to get out of his cage. And I'm in a science classroom with these big, long, black tables, lab tables, with gas and water and all that, sinks and the whole deal. And Marmaduke the ferret is out having the time of his life. He loved being out of his cage, apparently. And so when I came into the building, turned the lights on in my classroom, immediately turned to my left to check the cage for Marmaduke, he was gone. And so I started looking around the building, around the room. I walked down the right side of the classroom, and then I realized the snake cage was open too. So I knew in my heart something bad had probably happened. Marmaduke's pretty feisty, but nothing compared to that 6-foot boa. And that boa is a great hunter. And that boa is stealthy and silent and patient. Marmaduke's just happy-go-lucky. He's just having a good time. He has no idea that there's anything in that classroom that could eat him. But that snake, being a great predator, knew what he was doing. As I went through the classroom looking for Marmaduke, he came scurrying out from under a lab table, out from under a chair. And then I noticed the snake. The snake was right on top of where Marmaduke was, looking down over at Marmaduke. It was just a matter of time until Marmaduke got wiped out by the snake. Because the snake is a predator. He knows how to use camouflage and stillness to make himself totally invisible. An invisible enemy is a totally dangerous enemy. And little Marmaduke had no idea what was about to happen in his life. Luckily, I got there just in time. But you know, snakes, like that snake, are so stealthy. They're ultimate predators. Like this guy. An ultimate predator, a hunter. You're a predator, right?
I'm a predator.
You're a predator. Your role in life is to come out here and find animals and harvest them.
That's correct.
So this is my friend John Carpenter. He's a turkey hunter. He's got some things to share with us about what predators do. So John, what is it about great hunters that are like a great, like that snake? I mean, that snake has a lot in common with a predator, any kind of predator in the woods, a wolf, even an eagle, any of the alpha at the top of the apex. How is a hunter similar to that predator?
Well, a hunter is similar to a predator because he actually is a predator. Man is a predator and has been for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, thousands of years. But modern day predators, as myself, we use different methods, camouflage, but your best camouflage is being still, being stealthy and being still and quiet and blending into your environment. And like I heard you say, the snake, he was just being stealthy, being quiet, and that's how they acquire their prey, by being stealthy and silent and invisible.
So John, man, tell me about how you got into turkey hunting.
Well, actually it was my oldest brother that got me interested in turkey hunting. I was probably about 22 years old, 21, 22 years old. And he asked me, he says, "You wanna go turkey hunting?" I said, "I've never been." He said, "Well, you know, come and go hunting with me." He said, I'll tell you a few tips and, you know, put you out in the woods and see if you can't kill a turkey." Well, it was not that easy.
Right, so John, this thing you got in your hand there, and tell us about...
It's my weapon.
Tell us about...
Weapon of choice.
The weapon of choice for a predator like you. Why? Why that weapon?
It makes me more successful. Just put it mildly. It makes me more successful. I used to... My old gun, it had open sights. And through the years, my eyesight has gotten worse. So I decided, well, I'm going to upgrade to a scope. Well, needless to say, when I retired, my wonderful, beautiful wife bought me a gun for my retirement, a new turkey gun for my retirement.
So the mission of a predator is to get prey, right?
Right.
So your mission as a hunter is to what?
To harvest an animal.
And that tool helps you. You could have used, really.
I could use a $200 gun. Any amount priced weapon will suffice.
So when you want to harvest a prize bird, you want to use the best possible tools you can as a predator.
Exactly.
To harvest them.
I want to use the best I can buy, and you have to be proficient with it. Also, you know, if someone is not a good marksman, the highest priced gun in the world is not going to help them. You have to be a good marksman.
So for just a minute, John, take me into the mindset of being invisible as a hunter. What is it about invisibility that makes you so powerful as a predator?
Just knowing that you're there and he doesn't know you're there, and you're about to accomplish your goal because you've done everything right. And he made one mistake of coming to you.
Tell me again, how do you get him to come to you?
Call him with the hen call.
And why does he come to that?
Because it's a breeding season, and he knows that he has to pass his genes on.
So John, what's it take to be a great hunter?
Well, for one thing, you have to be almost make yourself invisible. You have to be as stealthy as possible in the woods. You have to have good woodsmanship. You have to be a fairly decent caller to get the gobbler to respond and to get him to come to where you want him to come to in your range. You know, by being stealthy and quiet and invisible, like you see with a full face mask, gloves, you don't want anything, any part of your body showing. And probably the most important thing is being still, sitting still. Somebody with ants in their pants fidgeting around is not going to be successful. You can't be scratching your head. You can't be, moving from one side to the other. I usually sit on the ground when I'm hunting. And you just have to make sure that you're still. That's the best camouflage in the world, is being still. You know, you can have the best camouflage that they make, and if you can't sit still, then you will not be successful, I promise. Because the turkey's eyesight is so much better, and they can see you actually blink your eye at 100 yards, 50 yards. So you have to, all your movement has to be slow motion when you get ready to take your shot to harvest your animal. And it's just a matter of like you said, being invisible and blending into the natural habitat.
So then you're calling them in. Can you show us what that sounds like or what that looks like?
This is what you call a mouth call. The correct word is a diaphragm call, which, you know, I hope nobody takes offense to that. But
so what's your hope with that call? What do you hope goes on in the gobbler's mind when you're using that call?
You're hoping you sweet talk him enough to get him interested to come visit you. That's the whole purpose in trying to lure him in, to get him into your range. Effective range, I should say.
So you don't go hunt him, you make him come to you.
Yeah, you don't hunt him because, like I said earlier, they see and hear so well that you will not sneak up on gobbler in the woods. They are just, their ability to escape danger is so keen, it's just unbelievable.
So you're using that gobbler's own natural instincts to call him in, become your prey.
Right. That's the object of the sport of turkey hunting.
Well, yeah. You calling him into a danger zone.
Danger zone.
You're putting him right in harm's way by using his own powerful instincts against him.
Right. That's correct.
Wow. So a while ago you mentioned that maybe if you can't get him interested in the hen, you might do something else.
Right.
To trigger his ego. What do you do to trigger this guy's ego?
Well, there's gobbler calls that you can use, and I would never use one on public ground, but you can actually, if you're on private ground, you know you're the only one around hunting, then you can actually you can challenge him to a fight, more or less, because turkeys they're just like all other animals. They have a pecking order where the most dominant bird is going to do most of the breeding. So you want to challenge him by sounding like another gobbler. I can do that real
quick.
Yeah,
so I'd like for you to do that. So if you can't get him to come to the hen, you're going to get up in his ego.
Right, right.
All right. Then let's see how that works.
So I'll use a hen call, this gobbler that's 100, 200 yards away, he thinks another gobbler has come into his territory to steal his girlfriend, that he's trying to get her to come to him, and he's being stubborn. So you want to try to, you think, well, I'll challenge him, tell him that I'm going to steal his girlfriend. I'm another gobbler. So that's what this is about.
So if you can't get him to come through the natural physiology of needing to breed and propagate the species, you're going to challenge his ego and try to get him to break his pattern of staying away,
right,
and get him to come into territory that there's no way, right, he should ever be in.
Right, that's exactly right.
Show me what the ego's challenge sounds like again. Gentlemen, listen real closely. That's what it sounds like right before Satan calls you into the death zone. It's going to be some hen. It's going to be some ego challenge, and it's going to put you right in the middle of the death zone. So thanks so much, John, for teaching us about turkey hunters. Y'all are just a little bit crazy. So there's at least six things that we've learned about turkey hunters today, haven't we? Number one, we've learned that they study their prey, and they know the turkey's weaknesses and strengths. Number two, the hunter uses every means possible to deceive the turkey. Number three, the hunter uses the turkey's natural appetites to lure him in. And number four, the hunter cannot wait to make a trophy out of the turkey to hang on his wall. Number five, the hunter is more patient, more skillful, more sneaky, more cunning, more stealthy, and deadlier than the turkey could ever imagine. This alpha predator, the hunter, has an enormous range of skills, tactics, and tools to lure the turkey into the kill zone. So what is it that gets turkeys harvested? What is it about turkeys? Number one, a lack of awareness. They are unaware of the enemy's presence. The enemy, the turkey, acts like it has no invisible enemy. Number two, the turkey's inability to sense the presence of his hidden enemy. Number three, the turkey's natural desires draw him in. And number four, the hunter uses deception, uses a fake call to lure the turkey in. And number five, the turkey is deceived by decoys that look like the real thing. And then the male turkeys, the tom turkeys, man, these guys are crazy. The tom turkey gets his ego challenged and runs straight into the kill box. Number seven, the tom turkey is clue-free about how intentional the hunter is about harvesting his tail feathers and his beard to hang on the hunter's wall in the hunting cabin. Quite honestly, the eighth thing is that the turkey lacks wisdom. The hunter will come back into the turkey space over and over and over and over again for days in order to harvest that prize bird. So the turkey far underestimates his enemy's persistence and firepower. Now, this is what I've noticed about humans, is that there are at least, get my fingers right here, eight things that turkeys do that humans do too. I've been pastoring for a while. I've seen these things. I've done these things myself. These are things that humans do that turkeys do too. When we are unaware that we have an enemy, we're much more likely to get harvested by him. The second thing we do, we are not diligent when we miss the signs when we're entering the kill zone. The third thing that makes us like turkeys, we are not aware that our natural appetites for food and power, money, more stuff, fame, sex, and relationships can lead us into the kill zone where we become fair game for our enemy. Number four, we do not know that the enemy can use calls that sound just like the real thing to fake us out. Our enemy can use calls that sound like things we feel like we have to have. The fourth thing that makes us like turkeys is that we do not know that the enemy can use calls that sound like whatever we think we need. The enemy can even make his voice sound like God's. Now that's scary, isn't it? The enemy can even use scriptures. Did you know that? He used scriptures on Jesus in a showdown in the desert in Matthew 4. He used scripture against Jesus
Fortunately, Jesus knew the meaning and the understanding of the scripture. So friends, even scripture can be used by Satan against you. So he can make his voice sound like God. He is the deceiver, also known as the dragon from the book of Revelation. And as Tolkien told us in his Lord of the Rings trilogy, it doesn't do good to fail to take account of a live dragon when you live near one. And friends, we live near an invisible enemy that the book of Revelation calls the dragon. And this dragon is more deadly than the coronavirus ever could be because it works at the soul level. Our enemy seeks not just to kill your body, but to destroy you and take you away from God forever if he can. So be very aware that there is an enemy about. There is an enemy seeking to destroy us. Now, my first challenge is with you related to Satan is that over 60% of Christians don't even believe there is a Satan. We believe in some nebulous force, but keep in mind, this is why I believe there's a Satan, because Jesus did. Jesus had a showdown with the devil, but he also taught us to pray that we would not, that for deliverance from the evil one. He did not pray for deliverance from some nebulous force. He said, deliver us from evil, deliver us from the evil one. Okay, so those are some things to keep in mind as we talk about what's going on here. So the fifth thing that makes us like turkeys is we do not know that the deceiver will plant decoys that look exactly like what we desire to lure us into his kill zone. Number six, our ego launches us into a response to protect our turf. And then we make fatal mistakes and we run right into the hunter's kill zone. We're totally unaware that we're about to get harvested. The seventh thing that makes us like turkeys sometimes is we get in a hurry to have what we want right now. Number eight, we fail to understand how patient, cunning, stealthy, hidden, and deadly our enemy is. So the question becomes, how do we keep from getting harvested by our enemy? There are five power moves to defeat your invisible enemy. Admit that you have an enemy who wants to destroy you. That's where we begin. Some of us don't have any awareness at all that we have an enemy. And then be alert and make a sober assessment of your weaknesses and your enemy's strengths. Next thing, you got to stand up, suit up, and pray up. Stand up, suit up, and pray up. Paul, in his letter to the church in Ephesus, told them how to overcome this hidden enemy, this invisible enemy that we all have. And here's what he said in Ephesians chapter 6, specifically Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. Finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by his vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. So we gotta stand up and be aware. We gotta put on this full armor that we'll get to in just a moment. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. For this reason, take up the full armor of God, so that you may be able to resist an evil day, and having prepared everything, to take your stand. So you got to stand up, and then you got to suit up. Stand, therefore, with truth like a belt around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. In every situation, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit and with every prayer and request. And stay alert, stay alert, stay alert, stay alert. So friends, I'm praying that you will take this message to heart so that you will win the battle against your most deadly, invisible enemy, the dragon, Satan, the deceiver. So let me run through these five things that you must do to win. Realize and admit that you do have an enemy. Number two,
Be alert and make a sober assessment of your weaknesses and your enemy's strengths. And then, friends, you got to stand up, suit up, and pray up. Stand up, suit up, and pray up. Oh, yeah, last thing. Don't be a turkey.
Yeah.
your triumph unfold. He's never failing. He's never failing.
Good morning, FOS family. It has been a blessing worshiping with you today. I am so proud to be a part of this community, and I wanted to come to you from my basement / craft space / the only place in my house where there isn't any children to say thank you. Thank you for stepping it up this week in a really big way. We provided an opportunity for you to give this week to buy $5 gift cards from LaGrange Coffee Roasters for the hospital staff in LaGrange. We didn't know how quickly you would respond, but boy, did you respond. Within 4 hours, all 200 gift cards were purchased. It was amazing to watch and such a blessing to see all those emails coming in that said, another one was purchased, another one was purchased. I'm just so grateful for you guys and how you always step it up. The next day, someone called me and asked if they could match your donation of $1,000 to possibly buy $10 gift cards for the hospital staff. So that's exactly what we did. On Friday, Jeff and Julie were able to take $10 gift cards over to the hospital for everyone on staff there. What a blessing that was. And again, thank you for stepping it up and for being a part. I really want to challenge you to keep looking for those opportunities. Keep looking for places to serve and to stay connected. We have a couple opportunities on our Facebook page during the week where you can stay connected. One of those is Daily Hope. It's every weekday at 12:15. You can hop on. Jeff will be there live on Facebook to offer an encouraging word and to offer a space for you to share and connect with one another. We also have an online small group at 8 o'clock on Wednesday nights, open to everyone, where you can hop on. We use Zoom. You can hop on, find the meeting ID under events on our Facebook page, and then join us at 8 o'clock on Wednesday nights. Don't miss an opportunity to love one another this week. Don't miss an opportunity to connect, and don't miss an opportunity to see Jesus everywhere you are. Have a great week.